Let's get ready for our first game.
It's
what do we got?
Time to play Cow Turkey Pilgrim, the game where you can be a cow, a turkey, or a pilgrim. If your choice gets eliminated, then you are out.
All right, pick one. Everybody stand up. I need to see your best cow, turkey, or pilgrim. What is it, Thanksgiving or something? Round one. Let me see it. Let me see some cows. Let me see some turkeys. I need to hear them. Can I hear some cows and turkeys? I'm going pilgrim. Oh, cows, you're out. You're going to have to move along. Round two, here we go. Trust me, the jokes don't get any better. Yep. Here we go. Let me see your favorite. Let me hear it. What's a turkey sound? Oh, the pilgrim's out. If you got a hat, you're out. Round three.
He's a turkey.
A turkey. I could just kind of stand there and be one. All right, let me hear some turkeys. There's no turkeys. I think the turkey on this side is not feeling well. Oh, pilgrim again.
Phew.
Nobody likes the pilgrims. Nope, round four. How many rounds do we have? All right, let me see it. I'm going cow. They're being nice to the turkey because the turkey gets it on Thursday. That's why. Oh, that was it. Yeah, the turkey didn't get it. All right, everybody up. It's wiggle song time.
Wiggle.
Giggle and giggle and giggle and giggle and freeze. I'm gonna wiggle and giggle and wiggle and giggle and freeze. Jump up high and turn around. Touch your fingers on the ground. Make your favorite animal sound.
Woo.
Let me hear it.
Woof, 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 woof.
Ooh,
woof,
that was pretty good. Good morning, Creekside kids again. How are you today?
Good.
That was okay. I think we can do a little better. How are we?
Good.
All right, the left side of the room woke up. Outstanding. All right, who am I again? I haven't been up here in a while. That's right.
That's right.
Senor Bacon. I am so happy to see you. We are going to have some fun today. We got three cool songs still coming. My bad. Got another cool game coming. And we got some cool stories. Oh, I can't wait till story time. But first, let's do a game. Campbell, come up here and help me, man. Bacon Bits, off to the side. You are Bacon Bits. All right. You're going to have to tell me which of these four answers is the top one, all right? You ready? You guys help him. Something you eat that's soft. Cake, ice cream, marshmallows, bread. What do you got?
Marshmallows.
I don't know. Bread's pretty soft. What do you guys think?
It's marshmallows.
Ice cream.
Ice cream's good.
Ice
what
cream.
Do we got? Survey says, marshmallows number one.
What? Woo-hoo.
All right, Campbell, good job. You're one for one. You ready for round two? Here we go. I like the delay. Something that is slippery. An eel, soap, wet floor, or ice. What do you got?
Wet floor.
Who's got wet floor?
Wet floor.
Who's got soap? Who's got eel? Eels are yucky. Services. Soap. Oh, Campbell, you're number two. All right. Something that goes good with milk. Cereal, brownies, cookies, cake. Campbell, what do you got?
Cookies.
Oh, cereal without milk, that's just crazy talk. Survey says cereal. Something that you wear that starts with an S.
It's a shirt.
Shoes, shorts, socks, shirt. Which one's your favorite?
All of the above.
Not an answer. I'm going to need one of the four.
Shorts
is what he calls. And it's shirt. No one wants to see you with a shirt off. Something a small child does a lot. Eat, play, yell, cry. I'm going with cry.
Cry.
Campbell.
Yell.
Campbell's going with yell. Can I hear somebody yell?
Woo!
Whoa. Yell, not screech. All right, survey says play. Man, little kids cry all the time. Does your sister cry? Be careful. She's standing like right there. All right. Is that it? Do we got another one? We got nothing. Thanks, Campbell. How about we back the song up then? Man, the sound crew is on fire today. All right, you guys ready for a song? Let's go. Everybody up.
You are here.
All right, it's time for the key passage. And this week's key passage, John 11:25. Repeat after me. Jesus said to her.
Jesus said to her.
I am the resurrection.
I am the resurrection.
And the life.
And the life.
The one who believes in me.
The one who believes in me.
Even if he dies. Will live.
Will live.
And where's that found? John.
John.
Chapter 11.
Chapter 11.
Verse 25.
Verse 25.
All right, everybody up. We got a song about it. Good job, good job. Hey, give a hand for the praise band here. Yay. Thanks for coming, guys. That way. Go, 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 go. All right, you guys can sit down. You guys ready for a story?
Oh.
If we only had someone that could tell us a good Bible story.
Yeah, we're going to work on that.
Who can we get? You guys got any ideas?
Yeah.
Who? How about Mr. David?
Yeah.
Will that work?
Jesus is great, though. I wished he was here to tell the Bible story.
What if we told a story about
Jesus? That'd be fantastic.
So let's welcome Mr. David. You guys ready? On three, say, hey, Mr. David. One, two, three.
Hey, Mr. David. Okay, all right. Let's look at the big picture question here. Where is Jesus now? Who knows? He's in heaven. What? What happened? He got crucified, he was resurrected, and he went to where? Does anybody know where in heaven he sits? In a chair. Well, that's a good idea, in a chair. Where would he sit? He has this particular place he sits in heaven. He sits at the right hand of the Father. You see, and when you have a king, his best man, his best person always sits on his right. Always. Jesus ascended to heaven where he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he's up there. And listen, every time when you pray, I've told you this before, when you pray, your prayers go to him and he listens to them and he tells the Father and then the Father decides what he's going to do. He's there listening the whole time. Okay? Today's story is Jesus goes back and sees his disciples. And we're going to have to talk about it in a little bit because sometimes, boys and girls, when you hear something, do you always believe what you hear? Nope. We're going to see why. So let's watch our story right now, okay?
Okay. On the first day of the week, in the evening, the disciples gathered together in a house. They locked the doors because they were afraid of the Jews. They didn't want to be killed like Jesus had been killed. But some of Jesus' disciples had reported seeing him alive. Was it true? As the disciples talked, Jesus appeared among them and said, "Peace to you." The disciples were afraid. They thought they were seeing a ghost. "It's me," Jesus said. "Look at me and touch me. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, but I do." Jesus showed his disciples his hands and his side. They saw his wounds. The disciples rejoiced because they were so happy to see Jesus. The disciples gave Jesus some fish to eat. Jesus talked to them and explained the Bible to them. "The Bible is about me," Jesus said. He helped them understand how the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms told about him. Then Jesus told the disciples that they had a job to do. Jesus had died and was raised from the dead so that people could be forgiven for their sins. The disciples needed to tell other people to repent from their sins and be forgiven. Jesus said, "God sent me to earth, and in the same way, I am sending you." One of Jesus' disciples, Thomas, was not with the others when Jesus visited him. He did not believe that Jesus was alive. Thomas said, "I want to see and touch the holes in his hands and his side, or I will never believe." A week later, Thomas was with the disciples when Jesus appeared again. Jesus said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Reach out and touch my side. Don't be an unbeliever. Believe." Thomas did believe. "My Lord and my God," he said. Jesus said, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Those who believe in me without seeing me are blessed." For 40 days, Jesus presented himself to more than 500 people and proved that he is alive. Jesus is still alive today. We have not seen Jesus, but if we believe in him, we will be blessed. He sends out believers to tell others about him and gives us power through the Holy Spirit.
I'm sitting there looking out in the audience today, and we have Bo Davis here. And Bo Davis was as young as you were one day, and he's actually here today as a helper. And I want you guys right here on this front row to do me a favor. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about that Bo Davis. But I need for you guys to help him out by sitting and being quiet, okay, Graham? Can y'all do that for me this morning? Okay. Now, a while ago, I asked you a question. I said, "Do you always believe everything that you hear?" And a lot of you said what? What'd you say? No, you don't always believe. Let me ask you this. Can you always believe everything you see? No, right. See, y'all are so smart, you know everything. Magic is out there, and they do stuff, and you look at it, and you go, "Oh, that was a cool trick. How'd he do that?" But you know what he really did didn't really take place. Today in our story, Thomas has that same problem. Now, I'm going to do something for you. I'm going to ask you a question, and I want you to answer as loud as you can, because some of you are going to know this answer, because you were in and through Children's Church. So you guys that have been through Children's Church before and you know this answer, don't answer. Just the kids that are here. Now, can a donkey talk? It cannot talk. Are you sure it can't talk? Are you sure a donkey has never talked? You think it can? Campbell says it can. Anybody else, you think it can? It can't? How many of you would say, "No, it can't"? Okay, how many of you would say, "Yes, it can"? Well, there's a lot more no's. I'm going to read you something out of the book of Numbers. Okay, pay close attention. It says, "But God's anger was kindled because he went, and the angel of the Lord took his stand in the way as his adversary now. And he was riding on the donkey, and his two servants were with him. And the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand. And the donkey turned aside out of the road and went into the field. And Balaam struck the donkey with a rod. Then the angel of the Lord stood in a narrow path between the vineyards with a wall on either side. And when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, she pushed against the wall and pressed Balaam's foot against the wall. So he struck her again. And when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, she pushed against the wall and Balaam struck her again. Then the angel of the Lord went ahead and stood at a narrow place where there was no way to turn either to the right or to the left. So she lay down under Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he struck the donkey still a third time. Now we said, you know, donkeys can't talk. But listen to what happens. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and she said to Balaam, What have you done? You have struck me three times. And Balaam said to the donkey, because you have made a fool of me. I wish I had a sword in my hand, for then I would kill you. And the donkey said to Balaam, am I not your donkey on which you have ridden all your life, long to this day? It is my habit to treat you this way. And he said, no. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes and he could see the angel. You see, boys and girls, sometimes when you hear things, especially that come out of this book, you can bet your bottom dollar it's 100% true. There are other stories, though, that you get told that you may think, well, they're true or they're not true. I'm going to tell you one. Back in the day, back in the day, my grandmother lived on 91 Hawkins Street. She had a cement porch house. And the house across the street were the Turners, and they lived there. Mrs. Turner was about 89 years old when this happened. Now, I'm told this is a true story. But you know, it's a story that Mr. David has seen in his mind over and over, and I have found it hard to believe. So when I get done, I want you to tell me if you think it's true or you can't believe that it's really true, or if you would have to decide if it was true only if you could see it. One day, Mrs. Turner's boy was out working on his car, and back then, a 56 Chevy weighed a ton. I mean, it was super, super heavy. It wasn't like the cars today that are made with 90% plastic around a little bit of metal. It was all metal. If you ran a new car into an old car today, the old car would get a dent in it and the new car would be demolished. Be that simple. But her boy loved to work on his cars. Graham, you guys on the front row have got to be quiet, okay? And Mrs. Turner would sit on the porch while he was out there working on it, and she would watch what was going on. Well, on this certain occasion, he had jacked the car up, and he put it under some blocks, and he was working on the back tire, and to get it fixed, he had to crawl under the car. And somehow, his foot slipped, and when it did, it kicked the block out from under the car, and the car wheel fell down on top of her boy. And she's 89 years old. He screamed as loud as he could, yelled, and a few of the neighbors in the street, they lived right across the street, heard it, and they ran out the door. And this is what they saw. They said Mrs. Turner, 89 years old, had a flight of steps that was probably four more steps up higher than this on that house. Said she ran down those steps, reached down and picked the back end of that car up by herself, and her son was able to crawl out from under the car. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I've tried to pick up cars. I can't pick up the ones today. I can't even get them off the ground. Oh, I can make the shock go up some. But I'm thinking to myself, there is no way in this world that that old woman could have picked up that car. But my grandmother says to this day, she's passed on now, but till the day she passed away, she said, I saw that with my own eyes. Now, let me ask you something. I told you that story. How many of you believe it's true? Anybody in here say why you believe it's true? Bo, why do you believe it's true? You trust me? You trust me to tell the truth, right? And that's what the case would be. Is we find good integrity in a lot of people, and you put your faith and trust in those people. In our story today, Thomas would not believe that Jesus was alive until he got to see the prints in his hands and the nail and the spear that was in his side. And that was kind of sad to me. Because boys and girls, you and I oftentimes will pick up our Bible and we will read it and we'll want to question it. And when you get older, you're going to want to do this. Can I encourage you now to understand it? Know that everything in the Bible, you're not going to understand. If you ever come in contact with another human being on this world that tells you, I can figure out all the secrets of the Bible, don't pay him a whole lot of attention. Because the truth is, we're never going to figure out God's word. But here's the good part. It's 100% true. I can walk away from anybody who's wanting to argue with me with the Bible and say, that's not true. And I look at them honestly and say, you're just wrong. You're dead wrong. It is true. It happened. It took place. A donkey talked. I want to read for you today the ending of the story when Thomas does get to see Jesus, because there is something in the end of this story that I tell you all the time, and I want you to remember it as you're growing old, because here's the deal. It's something that nobody can take away from you, and that is your faith in God. That are the promises that he's given you in his word. Did you know that you have a promise from God right now that he keeps every time it rains? Do you know what the promise is? What's the promise? Rainbow. He puts it in the sky. And what has he said? He says, I will never, ever again destroy the world by flood. Now, I know what you're thinking, because I get this all the time too. People say, oh, but Mr. David, over in Africa, it flooded. And 30 or 40 people died from the flood. God said he'd never make it flood. No, he didn't. God said he would never destroy the entire world by flood. He didn't say that disasters wouldn't come to parts of the world. He kept his promise. In John 20, 14, 19 through 30, listen to this story, okay? I'm going to read it right out of the Word of God, so I want you to pay close attention. Because on the video sometimes, they leave out a few words that I think are important. The disciples were afraid of the Jewish leaders, and on the evening of the same Sunday, they locked themselves in a room. Suddenly, Jesus appeared in the middle of the group. He greeted them and showed them his hands and his side. And when the disciples saw the Lord, they became very happy. Wouldn't you be happy if someone that you thought was dead showed up? Or would you be scared? I might have stood there in a little bit of a shock. Ooh. Wait a minute. I saw them take you off the cross. I saw them put you in a tomb. I saw them roll away the stone. Ooh. What are you doing here? He goes on to say, after he had greeted them, he said, I am sending you just as the Father sent me. Then he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they will be forgiven. But if you do not forgive their sins, they will not be forgiven. Jesus also told them that day that you have already been told several times that I was going to come back to life. And you know what? Some of them had a hard time believing that, because you know what? They had never seen anybody come back to life except Lazarus. I bet they were there that day. But Jesus said, I will come back to life. And they were like, yeah, okay. We didn't see Lazarus die. He got sick. We did see you raise him from the dead, because you're a great and mighty prophet. But if you get killed, who's going to raise you back to life? And we all know the answer. God the Father will. And he did. Although Thomas the twin was one of the 12 disciples, he wasn't there with the others when Jesus appeared to them. So they told him, we have seen the Lord. Now here's Thomas. Just like me, I wasn't there the day Mrs. Turner picked that car up. My grandmother was. And I probably looked the first time my grandma told that story and said, oh, no way she picked up that heavy old car. And then my grandma said, have I lied to you before? And I said, well, no, I've never known you to lie to me before. I'm telling you, she picked up that car. Here was Thomas with people he had been with for several years. He had been with Jesus. And they told him, Thomas, Jesus was here. And he said, yeah, right. I don't believe that. But Thomas said, first I must see the nail scars in his hands and touch them with my finger. I must put my hand where the spear went into his side. I won't believe unless I do this. A week later, the disciples were together again. Thomas was with them. Jesus came in while the doors were still locked and stood in the middle of the group. He greeted his disciples and he said, Thomas, put your finger and look at my hands. He said, put your hand onto my side. Stop doubting, Thomas, and have faith. Thomas replied, you are my Lord and my God. Jesus said, Thomas, you have faith because you have seen me. The people who have faith in me without seeing me are the ones who are really blessed. You know who he's talking about? He's talking about you. He's talking about me. I have never in my life seen Jesus. Oh, I've got an idea of what he possibly looks like from paintings and pictures that we've seen. But not one time have I ever seen Jesus except for in things where I know that God is moving. Like sometimes he moves in the wind. Sometimes he moves in the rain. Sometimes he moves when I'm hungry and he gives me food to eat from my body. He moves in mysterious ways that we will never be explained. But do you know something? I have never seen Jesus, but I believe. I believe, as the Bible says, with my heart, my mind, and my soul. And if it were to cost me my life, and I hope it wouldn't, but if it were to cost me my life, I would hope that I would never say that I don't believe in who Jesus is. And I hope when you grow older that you will too. Jesus worked many other miracles for his disciples, but not all of them were written in this book. But these are written so that you may put your faith in Jesus as the Messiah and the Son of God. If you have faith in him, you will have eternal life. Put your faith and trust in the Word of God. Put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and you will have eternal life. One day, I'm going to go to sleep. Notice I didn't say I'm going to die. It is a physical death, but one day I'm going to sleep, and I'm going to wake up in heaven. Right there with Jesus, right there with God. You see, boys and girls, don't be a doubting Thomas as you get older. Always remember the words of God, and always remember, no matter what, they are 100% true. And you don't have to try and prove them. All you have to do is stand firm upon the Word of God, and God will prevail for you. If you're listening today, maybe you haven't accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. I hope and pray that maybe you'll do that today. Maybe will be the appointed time today that you accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, so that you too may obtain eternal life. You know, my grandmother's in heaven. My grandfather's in heaven. Fortunately, right now, my mom and dad are not in heaven. But do you know what? When they pass away and they leave this world, yeah, I'm probably going to be a little bit sad. But the truth is, I've been told through the Word of God that one day I will see them again. And I believe that with all my heart. I hope you too will today. Trust Jesus as your Savior today if you haven't already. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, we thank you so much for the fact that Jesus, many, many years ago, through the Word of God, we were told that you were coming as a baby. We were told that you would be crucified on a cross. We were told that you would rise again on the third day. And Father God, every bit of that came true. Thousands of years when it was written long ago came true. God, you have never one time lied. Lord, I pray today that these boys and girls, maybe these people out there listening and hearing this telecast, maybe, God, they haven't accepted you as their personal Lord and Savior. I pray, Lord, that you would send the Holy Spirit and knock upon their door. Through these hard times that we're going through, the greatest thing in the world to cling to is you. You are the great creator. You are the miracle worker. And you are the great healer. God, I pray today that there's a boy and girl sitting in this audience that has not accepted Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior, that today they would do so. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, everybody up. Let's sing A Beautiful Name.
The head.